I'm going to go ahead and get started. Committee will come to order. I'd like to begin this hearing by stating the Oversight Committee mission statement. We exist to secure two fundamental principles. First, Americans have the right to know the money Washington takes from them is well spent. And second, Americans deserve an efficient, effective government that works for them. Our duty in the Oversight and Government Reform Committee is to protect these rights. Our solemn responsibility is to hold government accountable to taxpayers because taxpayers have the right to know what they will get from their government. We will work tirelessly in partnership with citizen watchdogs to deliver the facts to the American people and bring genuine reform to the federal bureaucracy. This is the mission of the Oversight and Government Reform Committee. Let me walk through a quick opening statement, and then I will yield the floor to our ranking member to do the same. We are here today to discuss the Endangered Species Act, which is now in its 40th year. Happy birthday. The ESA is enacted to conserve habitats and species that are considered endangered or threatened. President Nixon signed it into law with the support of 99% of Congress. At the time, there were high expectations for the Endangered Species Act. President Nixon saying this new law will protect an irreplaceable part of our national heritage and threatened wildlife. However, over the years, some flaws with the Endangered Species Act have surfaced. There is a significant concern that some are using the Act to advance other policy goals, such as stopping development, instead of for its intended purpose of protecting threatened animal and plant species. Concerns also abound over whether or not the law gives the implementing agencies enough time to properly process the candidates for species listing. In one instance, Fish and Wildlife Service was active in a petition to examine 374 separate aquatic species, all from one petition, in the statutory 90-day time frame. As a result, the agency admitted that it was only able to conduct cursory reviews of the information in their files and the literature cited in the petition. This puts the agencies in a very difficult position. Process the enormous work brought in by a petition within 90 days or face a lawsuit for missing the deadline from the same groups bringing the petition in the first place. The massive amount of petitions lead to a transition towards sue and settle agreements. Whether by choice or not, the federal government faces lawsuits that are very often settled to the financial benefit of environmental groups and their lawyers. In many of these cases, states and others affected stakeholders are not even aware of the negotiations or what is being discussed until they are resolved. Also, there have been instances where much of the base of these settlements remains sealed. Thus, communities and stakeholders affected by these listings don't have a full view of what all occurred. In general, the lack of transparency of the data used to justify a species listing remains a major problem. In some cases, data gathered at taxpayer expense has not been publicly released. Transparency is essential to public faith in government. The less information the public has to understand the Endangered Species Act and how it is carried out, the less support the Act will have, and it will be even more difficult to process in the future. General success rate of the ESA has also come under criticism as well. Only a 2% recovery rate of the approximately 2,100 species listed on the Endangered Threatened List since 1973. As I discussed previously, we have seen how we get species on the list. However, the above statistic begs the question, how do species graduate off the list? Is 2% enough for success? Like all federal agencies in this time of belt tightening, the Fish and Wildlife Service and NOAA Fisheries have finite resources. They are spending all their time and resources getting species on the list. It is unclear if they are able to spend the time necessary and the finances necessary to get species off the list, which was the reason this law was passed in the first place 40 years ago. Some claim that success can be measured by adding species to the list, as their prospects will benefit once they get there. I hope that is the case. However, the goal of the law enacted 40 years ago was to rehabilitate species and to move them off the list, not perpetual staying on it. If Americans are going to have faith in the Endangered Species Act, they need to see how it works and that it works at all. Constantly heaping more species onto listings while barely moving any off of it will undermine that faith and raise questions about the Act's effectiveness. We also have to deal with the issues of how do we determine if the Act is being effective and when things are moved off. Are they moved off because of habitat or because of population numbers? Are those goals set in advance, and do the different communities even know how to have those goals achieved at all? ESA is jointly administered by Fish and Wildlife Service, the Department of the Interior, and the National Marine Fisheries Service under the National Ocean and Atmospheric Administration at the Department of Commerce. I am pleased that we have representatives of both agencies here today as witnesses, and I thank them for coming and look forward to hearing their answers to the subcommittee questions and to the conversation we will have today. I now recognize our ranking member, Mrs. Spear, for opening statement.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for holding this very important hearing, and thank you to the witnesses who are here to testify. You know, 40 years ago, the Endangered Species Act was passed with overwhelming bipartisan support from Congress. As President Nixon signed it into law, he said, quote, "Nothing is more priceless and more worthy of preservation than the rich array of animal life with which our country has been blessed," unquote. The Endangered Species Act, or ESA, has preserved our country's rich natural heritage, preventing the extinction of 99% of the plants and animals it protects. Without this landmark legislation, scientists estimate that as many as 227 U.S. species would have disappeared. My own state of California would be much poorer without our brown pelicans, our sea otters, and our bighorn sheep, all of which were saved by the ESA. Too often in Congress, the ESA has invoked some kind of legislative boogeyman. My colleagues on the other side of the aisle have on occasion been known to imply we would all be better off if we didn't have to protect this insignificant bird or that ugly flower. During the debate over the recovery package in 2009, the salt marsh harvest mouse, an endangered species found around San Francisco Bay, was blamed for an entirely fictitious spending boondoggle. Now, I do not want to find a salt marsh harvest mouse inhabiting my kitchen. But when they're living where they belong, these lesser-known species act as sentinels for the health of our ecosystems. When these species decline, they act as an early warning system for problems that will harm us as well. Species like the salt marsh harvest mouse or the endangered San Francisco garter snake that also lives in my district simply need healthy wetlands. This is a win-win, since the people of the Bay Area also need healthy wetlands to filter out pollution, buffer homes and businesses from storm surge and floods, and support thousands of fishing, tourism, and recreational jobs around the Bay. This holds for other threatened ecosystems, too, from the heights of the Sierra Nevada to the Great Plains short grass prairie. The ESA is also protecting future technological and biomedical advances. Bacteria found in a hot spring in Yellowstone National Park led to the discovery of an enzyme that underpins all basic genetic research and forensic techniques. Protein from a jellyfish supports advances in almost every aspect of biomedical science. To be clear, the bacteria and jellyfish that I mentioned are not listed under the ESA, but we do not know where the next discovery might come from. An endangered species could lead to the next medical breakthrough. By preventing extinction, the ESA preserves a natural medicine chest for the coming generations. Frequently, the ESA is blamed for tying up the courts in wasteful litigation. My colleagues on the other side of the aisle claim that the Department of Justice litigates an average of at least 3 cases a week dealing just with citizen suits under the ESA. However, Department of Justice data shows that civil litigation filed by industry and nonprofit organizations is far less than that rate. 119 lawsuits were filed in 2009, 111 in 2010, 57 in 2012, and only 23 through April 2012. Let's stick to the facts. The implementation of the ESA has not been perfect. ESA programs have been chronically underfunded. The FY 2013 appropriation approved by Congress for endangered species work at the Fish and Wildlife Service was $45.7 million less than the administration's 2013 requests. This has led to a substantial backlog of candidate species, which continues to decline, making recovery more difficult and expensive. Species also can't recover if there is no place for them to live. Since the passage of ESA in 1973, 25 million acres of land have been converted from undeveloped to developed, and 22 million acres have been converted from forested to non-forested areas, roughly the size of Virginia and South Carolina, respectively. But the answer to the limited resources is cooperation and coordination, not rolling back protections for vulnerable species. You know, when I was on the Board of Supervisors in San Mateo County way back in the 1980s, I helped to develop what was then called the Habitat Conservation Plan. It was the very first in this nation, and it was an experiment in part, but we had endangered butterflies, the Mission Blue, the San Bruno Elfin, and the Calliope Silver Spot. They were inhabiting an area where a developer wanted to build homes. So we came up with a Habitat Conservation Plan, created an opportunity for all of those endangered species to live and to thrive, and were able to build homes as well. So we worked with the developer and with the environmental community to achieve both housing and habitat conservation. These are the kinds of win-win situations that the ESA can help facilitate when we commit to protecting species instead of arguing about whether species should be protected. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back the balance of my time.
I would love to discuss at a future date how local leadership could make decisions about how to protect species as well. So we'll continue that maybe throughout the course of the day as well. Members will have 7 days to submit opening statements for the record. We'll now recognize our first and only panel of the day today. Mr. Sam Rauch is the Rauch, right? Okay, I said it wrong the first time. Rauch is the Deputy Assistant Administrator for the Regulatory Programs for the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's National Marine Fisheries Service in the Department of Commerce. It's a very long business card, by the way. Mr. Michael Bean is the Counselor to the Assistant Secretary for Fish and Wildlife and Parks at the Department of the Interior. Gentlemen, thank you both for being here. Look forward to our conversation. Pursuant to committee rules, all witnesses are sworn in before they testify. So if you please stand, raise your right hand, please. You solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you are about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God. Thank you. You may be seated. Let the record reflect the witnesses have answered in the affirmative. In order to allow time for discussion, I would like you to limit your initial testimony to 5 minutes. You have a clock in front of you there, your entire written statement. Thank you so much for submitting that. It will be a part of the permanent record, and then we will go into a dialogue from that point. Mr. Rao.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify before you today. My name is Sam Rauch, and I am the Deputy Assistant Administrator for Regulatory Programs for the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's National Marine Fisheries Service. We co-administer the ESA with the Fish and Wildlife Service. The purpose of the Endangered Species Act is to conserve threatened and endangered species and their ecosystems. Congress passed this law on December 28, 1973, recognizing that the natural heritage of the United States was of aesthetic, ecological, educational, recreational, and scientific value to our nation and its people. It was understood that without protection, many of our nation's living resources would become extinct. The Endangered Species Act has been successful in preventing species extinction. Less than 1% of the species listed under the law have gone extinct, and over 30 species have recovered. The National Marine Fisheries Service has recently delisted the eastern population of Stellar Sea Lion. This is the first delisting that has occurred because of recovery for the National Marine Fisheries Service since 1994, when we delisted the now thriving eastern population of Pacific gray whales. Action taken under the Endangered Species Act have also stabilized and improved the downward population trend of many marine species. For example, in 2013, we saw record returns of nearly 820,000 adult fall Chinook salmon passing the Bonneville Dam on their way up the Columbia River to spawn. This is the most fall Chinook salmon to pass the dam in a single year since the dam was completed in 1938, more than twice the 10-year average. Recovery of threatened and endangered species is a complex and challenging process. We engage in a range of activities under the Endangered Species Act that include listing species and designating critical habitat, consulting on federal actions that may affect a listed species or its designated habitat, and authorizing research to learn more about protected species. We also partner with a variety of stakeholders, including private citizens, federal, state, and local agencies, tribes, interested organizations and industry that have been critical to implementing recovery actions and achieving species recovery goals. For example, several NIMS programs provide support to our partners to assist with achieving recovery goals. From 2000 to 2012, the Pacific Coastal Salmon Recovery Fund provided $1.02 billion in funding to support partnerships in the recovery of listed salmon and steelhead. From 2003 to 2013, the Species Recovery Grants to states awarded $37 million to support state recovery and research projects for our listed species. And from 2001 to 2013, the Prescott Program awarded over $44.8 million in funding through 483 grants to stranding network members to respond to and care for stranded marine mammals. The National Fisheries Service is dedicated to the stewardship of living marine resources through science-based conservation and management. The Endangered Species Act is a mechanism that helps guide our conservation efforts and reminds us that our children deserve the opportunity to enjoy the same natural world we experience. Thank you again for the opportunity to discuss implementation of the Endangered Species Act, and I am available to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Rauch. Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Speer, members of the committee. It is a pleasure to appear before you. My name is Michael Bean. I am Counselor for Fish, Wildlife and Parks at the Interior Department. Rather than read my statement, sir, I would like to simply summarize what I think are some of the key points for you. Congress set an ambitious goal when it passed the Endangered Species Act, and that was simply to halt the slide toward extinction and to provide a more secure future for the wildlife and plant life that comprise our nation's natural heritage. And to perhaps a surprising degree, it's working. A recent example that I included in my testimony concerns the Oregon chub, a fish, one of four species that the Fish and Wildlife Service in this month has proposed to delist from the endangered species list. I want to note three aspects of that particular fish and its recovery that I think are noteworthy. First, that the listing and recovery of that fish generated little controversy. There were no major headlines, there were no major conflicts. Like most endangered species, the work that was done to recover it was done in a way that was both successful and generated few conflicts. Secondly, the recovery of that species benefited greatly from the help of private landowners who took advantage of new administratively created mechanisms to work with the Fish and Wildlife Service to cooperate in conserving that fish. Those agreements, called safe harbor agreements, are the same sorts of agreements that ranchers in Texas have used to help reintroduce the Apalmato falcon to that state after an absence from the U.S. of more than 50 years. Those same safe harbor agreements are akin to the ones that over 300 forest landowners in the Southeast, including some 28 forest landowners in Georgia, Mr. Woodall's state, who are in effect laying out the welcome mat on their property for an endangered species, the red-cockaded woodpecker. And as a result of their efforts, that species is growing in numbers on private land for the first time in a very long time. The third thing I want to note about the Oregon chub recovery is that it took over two decades to happen. And that's actually rather speedy because, unfortunately, for many endangered species, by the time we start efforts to conserve them, they are so reduced in numbers that the prospects of recovering them will inevitably take a very long time. I'll give you a few examples. The whooping crane. This country has, since the mid-1940s, when the numbers of that bird were fewer than 20, been engaged in a steadfast effort to recover it. And that has been successful, although it has taken some 70 years. We now have a wild population of roughly 400 or so whooping cranes in three populations, two of which were created through conservation actions. The California condor in Ms. Spears' home state and is now also in Utah and Arizona due to a translocation effort is a species that, like the black-footed ferret, was once extinct in the wild. That is to say, all the wild specimens were gone. The only specimens of those two species that survived were in captivity. And those two species became the subject of successful reintroduction, captive rearing and reintroduction programs. They are both now reintroduced in the wild. They are both reproducing in the wild. They both have a better shot at recovery than ever in their history. These and other examples of clear progress being made show that recovery is possible. Even for species that only a few decades ago seemed to face inevitable extinction. A few lessons that I draw from these experiences are, first, don't wait until species are in extremis. Get started early. That's when you have the best chance and you have the most options to succeed. And secondly, take advantage of what I argue will be the inherent flexibility of the Endangered Species Act to craft innovative solutions like the safe harbor agreements I've described, like the candidate conservation agreements that have made possible the decision not to list the desert, the dune sagebrush lizard in Texas, like the experimental population provisions of Section 10J of the Act that have helped restore both the whooping crane and the California condor, and like the flexibility provided through Section 4D of the Endangered Species Act to tailor requirements to the needs of threatened species. If we can learn from these lessons, and if we can heed Congress's own admonition when it passed this law to temper our economic and development, economic growth and development with adequate concern and conservation, then we can continue to make progress in reversing the slide toward extinction and getting on the road to recovery. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I recognize myself for a line of questioning. As I mentioned to both of you in advance, we will do 5 minutes of questioning, and then when we get into our second round, we are going to open it up for a more open colloquy. Let me just ask a couple of quick questions. Species at this point, how are they identified for concern? I know that's not an official term, but how does the initial process come out in both of the agencies to say we now recognize this species is something we need to look at closer? So can you tell me the process of how it gets into that?
I'll be happy to give an answer to that to start. Two ways the Fish and Wildlife Service addresses species that may be in need of the Act's protection. First, the service itself sometimes generates its own priorities of species that it, based on the information it has, believes.
So I'm asking, where is that information coming from? So you don't have a population count of every species of plant and animal and fish in North America, I would assume, that there's not some such listing somewhere, correct?
That is correct. Instead,
there has to be some way to be able to identify a certain plant, fish, or animal to say, okay, this is something we want to look at.
Yes, there are a variety of published and unpublished studies about the status of species. Certainly every state has a Fish and Wildlife Agency that tends to keep careful track of the trends of species in the state, and the Fish and Wildlife Service utilizes and accesses that information to determine whether any of those species may be declining or facing threats that warrant protection of the Act. So that's a very common mechanism. Secondly, the Act provides for citizen petitions, and any person can petition the Fish and Wildlife Service to consider for listing a species, and if the petition presents substantial evidence, the service then does a status review to determine, based upon all the evidence that's available from all sources, whether a proposal to list is appropriate.
Okay. Can I ask you a couple of quick questions, and we'll move on to Mr. Rock on that as well. What percentage do you think come from state agencies that are saying that there's a concern here, and what percentage of those currently, and you can take the last couple of years, and I know it's going to be an estimate. What are coming from state agencies identifying it? What are coming from citizen petitions?
We have, in the last several years, been heavily weighted towards citizen petitions. As you noted in your opening statement, we have received some petitions to list multiple species, and those have occupied the great majority of the attention of the Fish and Wildlife Service.
So in the past, if you go back, where the species that were citizen suits coming, they would bring one or two species at a time, and you've seen a trend difference where now they're bringing hundreds at a time?
We, beginning 5 or 6 years ago, began to receive multi-species petitions, which were atypical prior to that.
I know Mrs. Spear had mentioned that the number of lawsuits is dropping dramatically, but you're saying the number of species included in each of those lawsuits and those petitions seem to be much higher.
I'm not talking about lawsuits, sir. I'm talking about petitions.
Okay, so the actual petition to request to get into, you've seen this big jump of the number.
There have been a few large petitions that have required a fair amount of attention from the Fish and Wildlife Service because of the number of species protected.
Okay, so how many do you think right now with the citizen petition that are sitting out there that citizens have brought in the last couple of years even? Are we talking 200? Are we talking 700?
Species subject to petition?
Yes.
I don't have that number. It's probably in the hundreds, but I don't have a precise
number. Okay, so we have 2,100 total that are currently threatened or endangered at this point, and we're having hundreds coming with citizens' petitions at this point asking to be listed and additional.
Yes, a petition does not mean the species will become
Correct.
Listed.
But it starts your review process.
Starts the review process. That is true.
Mr. Rack, thank you, by the way. Mr. Rack, what's the process for you?
Thank you, sir. We follow much the same process that the Fish and Wildlife Service follows by looking at different sources of information. The petition process in recent years has largely driven our listings, but before we get to the listing process, we do maintain a species of concern list, which we look at before they, as Mr. Bean said, the time to act to protect these species when you can do it at the least cost to the greatest effect is before they get critically imperiled. And so the point of our species of concern list is it identifies issues where we can work with the states and our partners well before the Endangered Species Act kicks in to try to deal with that. The one difference between us and the Fish and Wildlife Service is we do maintain a series of marine surveys of marine life in federal waters. And oftentimes our own surveys can feed into some of our analysis.
So it's not necessarily a state bringing species that are specific to that. It's more often your own population counts. Because that's what I'm trying to determine. How do they get on the species of concern? It's something you're tracking, a certain number in a population?
That is something that we track. I'm not aware that a state has petitioned us in recent memory.
Okay. Then the big question we'll deal with as we come through this is obviously getting on, and then it's a matter of getting off in the process. And then I want to yield to my ranking member, Mrs. Spear, for her questioning.
Thank you both for your service and for your participation here today. I guess I'd like to have an understanding of how we can measure the success of the Endangered Species Act. Some might suggest that you have to either prevent extinction or you have to delist a species to show that there has been some kind of success. And as you have mentioned, in many cases, they don't even get to the list until they are truly almost extinct, which makes it that much more difficult to recover. And I'm thinking in part of the bald eagle and the American alligator and their status. So I guess to each of you, I'd like to ask you, what would you count as success?
I'll be happy to begin. Thank you for the question. Clearly, the examples I gave earlier of the California condor, the whooping crane, the black-footed ferret, we are making extraordinary progress in giving those species a more secure future. But they are still endangered, and they will remain endangered probably for many more years. And so anyone who suggests that is a failure because they've not been recovered yet is really blind to the major progress that has been accomplished. So for me, I think an important indicia is simply, are they more secure? Are they more abundant? Are they more widespread? Have the threats to them been reduced? Clearly, we would like to get and hope to get and intend to get to a point where we can take these species off the list because they are no longer endangered. But as I've suggested in my testimony, that's often a very long process, and what is important is that we make progress over the course of the years, as we've done for a great many of these species.
Mr. Rauch?
For the Fisheries Service, the Marine Fisheries Service, we currently have 94 species on the list that our Fisheries Service is managing. Of those, only one of them has gone extinct over the time, and it may well have been extinct at the time of listing in 1973. Since then, we do measure our success in the terms of the number of stable or increasing populations. The species are critically imperiled, and many of them are in a steep decline at the time that they are listing. If we can stabilize them at all, that is a sign of success. And the majority of our species are either stable or increasing. We only have a few of those 94 that still are exhibiting a decline. And so I think that is how we measure our success at this point. I would love to measure it in terms of more recovered species like the stellar sea lion that we just did, but as Mr. Bean said, that is a long process.
So of these citizen petitions, how much time is afforded the review of these petitions? I think, Mr. Rauch, you indicated that most of your listings now come from citizen petitions, not from anywhere else. So is that a lion's share of the time that you spent doing your work is reviewing these petitions?
No. We do spend a substantial amount of time reviewing petitions, and most of our listing work does come through the petition process. But we spent a substantial amount of resources working on recovery. I listed at the beginning some of the resources working on salmon recovery in the western United States. We have made great strides in recovering monk seals and right whales. All of that is done post-listing. And so I don't have a breakdown. We don't calculate our resources in terms of how much time on listings versus others, but we do spend a substantial amount of resources and time on recovery efforts.
Let me just spend a couple minutes on habitat conservation plans since I cut my teeth on them decades ago. How many are there in the country now?
I don't have a precise number, but it's well over 500.
Is that right?
Yes, and they've been very widely used in California. They've been widely used by other local governments as a way of integrating concerns about endangered species with local land use planning decisions, and they've been quite successful. Particularly in California, but they're increasingly in use elsewhere as well.
Now, how do they compare to the safe harbor agreements?
Well, habitat conservation plans, as you know from your experience in San Mateo County, are designed for situations in which there is some development or other project that is planned that is going to cause some degree of harm to an endangered species. And what those plans do is to offset that harm with a mitigation program, typically by protecting certain lands from development. Safe harbor agreements are intended for landowners who are willing to voluntarily do things that improve or create or restore habitat on their land, thus attracting endangered species to it, or hopefully attracting endangered species to it, or allowing species already there to expand. And those agreements protect those landowners from any additional regulatory burden for having laid out the welcome mat on their land for endangered species. So that's the key difference.
Thank you. My time has expired.
Thank you. Recognize the gentleman from Utah, the home of the Utah prairie dog, Mr. Chaffetz.
Thank the chairman. We'll have to get you such a shirt. You'll enjoy it. Mr. Bean, you're obviously a very accomplished individual. Where did you grow up?
I grew up in a small town in Iowa.
Oh, very good. And at some point, I'm sure you'll look towards retirement way, way in the future. Do you have any idea where you might retire?
I haven't the foggiest.
My guess is it's probably not in Utah, right?
Utah is a great place. I'd consider it.
No, well, thank you. I guess one of the things that we're concerned about is, you know, Utahns feel like they live there. They've lived there for generations. They will live there in the future. They want what's best for the land, and wildlife is part of that. Why is it that there's so much resistance to taking state data and information under consideration when you're making these types of decisions?
Respectfully, sir, I don't think there is much resistance to taking state data. I think the Fish and Wildlife Service routinely uses information from the states in making its decisions.
We don't feel like that in Utah, quite frankly. Let me ask you this. The 2010 decision by Fish and Wildlife Service that the greater sage grouse warrants an ESA listing was based, as I understand it, on a 2009 taxpayer-funded Fish and Wildlife study, Service study. This study was cited 62 times in the listing decision, yet the data used in this study is still not been made publicly available. Do I have that right?
I don't know whether you have it right or not. I do know, as a general matter, that some of the underlying data for studies that the Fish and Wildlife Service relies upon is not publicly available.
Why not?
Because as I understand it, because the researchers who collected that data have it as a proprietary source of data.
How isn't that patently unfair? You're making a decision that affects people's lives and dramatically affects their way of living, and they can't see it?
Well, sir, the decision made in 2010 was not a decision to list the species. It had no effect upon anyone's life. There will be a decision forthcoming about whether to list.
It's going to be part of the decision-making process, is it not?
Well, there will be a decision made in 2015 on the sage grouse.
And they're going to rely upon some of that data, right?
Well, I don't know.
But why can't we look at it? Taxpayers paid for it.
It's not as though the Fish and Wildlife Service is withholding it. The Fish and Wildlife Service doesn't have it to give, as I understand.
Who paid for it?
I honestly don't know.
The taxpayers. Taxpayers paid for it. Why can't we see the information? It's not about some North Korea nuclear bomb that the military is. We're talking about data that should be made publicly available.
Sir, I can tell you that I am currently aware that the Fish and Wildlife Service is working quite closely with the state of Utah. Mr. John Harjaugh, representing Governor Herbert, is involved on a regular basis in dialogue with respect to Utah's efforts to protect the sage grouse. And any information from Utah or other sources relevant to whether that species should be listed will be fully taken into account by the service. I can assure you of that.
It seems to be a one-way street. And it shouldn't be. We've spent time with Mr. Harjaugh. He's a very good, talented individual. I don't feel like there's a good two-way communication. This is a taxpayer-funded study with data and information that we should be able to review and challenge. That's part of the open and transparent process where we're ultimately going to make some sort of decision. I'm running short of time here. I really don't understand the philosophy behind this. I don't think it's fundamentally fair. I think you're hiding something, and I think it should be made publicly available. And if you would please get back to this committee and try to articulate why you're hiding this information, we can't see it, I would greatly appreciate it, because I really don't understand it. The other part I want to ask about is, for instance, with the prairie dogs, how you count them on public lands, but not on private lands, but then if they're deemed to get on the list, then you have to manage them also on the private lands. Well, why? Explain that philosophy to me.
I think the Fish and Wildlife Service recovery plan for the prairie dog relied primarily upon recovering the species on public lands, and that was done, I believe, in part in recognition of the fact that for the most part, private landowners regard the Utah prairie dog as not a desirable thing to have on their lands, and therefore the prospects for recovery really depend upon securing its survival on public lands.
But when you're assessing how endangered they might be, you don't take into account what's on the private property.
Respectfully, sir, I do not think that is correct. I think the Fish and Wildlife Service takes into account all the prairie dogs in assessing whether or not they belong on the list.
All right. Well, that's a question that I would like to further explore with you. My time is expiring here, but I can tell you in general that the good people of Utah, they care deeply about their land. They pass this on from generation to generation. It's highly offensive when we have people who come in and make fundamental decisions about the longevity of the state and don't properly, I think, and take into account the state plans. The state data is not necessarily used with the consistency that we'd like it to. And it seems to be a one-way street, because when we ask for data from the federal government in how they're making these decisions before they're finally made, because once they're finally made, it's very difficult, we can't get our hands on that information. And that's the frustration. And it should be an open and collaborative process. I believe the states are in a much better position to draw up the plans, come to these conclusions, and gather this information. But, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the time. I'm well over. I yield back.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate you all being here. I'd encourage you to come look at the great state of Georgia when you're thinking about retirement, Mr. Bean. We have everything from close proximity to the oceans to close proximity to the mountains and wonderful folks and flora and fauna in between. I have great frustration about these ESA debates that we have, because I look around my community and I can't find anybody who loves native species more than we do. It's the hunters and the fishermen, it's the hikers and the bikers who are invested. I share Mr. Chaffetz's observation that I can't believe there's anybody in the nation that cares more about preserving the God-given benefits of Utah more than the folks who live in Utah. Why do you think here 40 years after a bipartisan effort, not just bipartisan agreement, but really a bipartisan effort to get the ESA passed into law. Why are we arguing about it instead of celebrating it? Mr. Rock, do you have is it obvious to you from where you sit?
I don't have an opinion on why.
The light should come on there when you hit the talk button.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. I don't have an opinion about why we continue to argue about it. I do think that both services have done in recent years have undertaken a significant effort to look for flexibilities in the current law, to forge partnerships. I think we both agree that if you're going to recover the species, it cannot be solely on the part of the federal government acting as a regulatory entity, but as a conservation partner. And I know that both services have tried in many instances to do that. And where we've been able to do that successfully, I think it has worked.
Well, I think about why suspicion how suspicion gets created. And it's very tough to get anything done around here without trust. And you need that basis of trust. I'm an attorney by training, but I look at the lawsuits in this area where attorneys are suing the federal government. I mean, you're talking about having a partnership with private sector entities. I mean, I'm just asking us to have a partnership with one another as a federal government. If this is the law of the land, if we are not only personally invested as public servants in making this happen, but publicly, personally invested as citizens in making this happen, is having the process driven by attorneys rather than by individuals, Mr. Bean, a part of what undermines public confidence in whether our goal is to preserve species or whether our goal is to manipulate a process to achieve yet a different goal?
Mr. Woodall, I think that the most successful efforts at conservation are ones that are carried out in cooperation with the local landowners. And in your state of Georgia, as I indicated, many of the landowners in the Red Hills area in the southwest part of the state are voluntarily participating in a Fish and Wildlife Service agreement known as a Safe Harbor Agreement to improve the habitat on that land for red-cockaded woodpeckers and other wildlife. Because, as you note, they care a great deal about their land and about the wildlife on it. And that's been a remarkably successful effort. It's been replicated next door in South Carolina and in Florida. So I think that's the best way to do things, and where the Fish and Wildlife Service has been able to sit down successfully with landowners and strike these agreements, great progress is being made. And we are committed to doing more of that, just as we have been committed to doing much of it in the past.
Well, but if you and I are invested in getting this done, if at a government level we're invested in getting this done, and if, as I would ask that we stipulate is true, if public trust is being undermined by the by not just the amount of litigation on the issue, but the size and scope and direction of the litigation on this issue, what would be the harm in eliminating attorney fees recoveries here? Because again, we're invested as individuals, we're invested as public servants. What if we took that small step to say, you know what, let's find the right answers, but let's not finance attorneys who might be doing the wrong thing and under the guise of helping to protect native species that we care so much about. Any harm in removing those attorney fees awards today, Mr. Rock?
I can't speak to that. The Justice Department would be better. I think that.
Well, let me just. I mean that. You have these issues come across your desk. If what you're saying is that your job would be much harder to do without private litigators, you would know the answer to that. But if private litigators are not value adds here, then it seems, you know, we have limited resources, limited opportunities. I don't have no one better than you to make the determination of whether or not this is mission critical, or whether or not this is a case of misapplied resources.
I know that the Fish and Wildlife Service has a significantly more Endangered Species Act litigation than we do. We do have some. We believe that we do devote resources to it, but it is not constraining our overall effort towards recovery. And I'm from Georgia, by the way. I was born and raised there.
And will we get you back?
Probably so.
I'm glad to hear.
But it was the 9th District.
We move the lines around frequently. You and I may be teammates yet again down the road. Mr. Bean?
Mr. Woodall, I'm a bit worried. I'm looking older than I am because you're all talking about my retirement here already. With respect to the litigation, the Fish and Wildlife Service is a equal opportunity defendant. We get sued not just by environmental groups, but in the last year or two, we've been sued by the National Association of Home Builders, by Weyerhaeuser Corporation, American Forest Resources Council, which is a timber industry group, and numerous others. We don't like to be sued by anybody, but I will say this, the fact that people are looking over our shoulder, our left shoulder and our right shoulder, does make us pay careful attention to dotting our I's and crossing our T's and getting it right as best we can. So there is a salutary benefit, as much as I hate to admit it, to being sued from sometimes, because that forces you to pay careful attention to what you're doing. So I think that's something that should not be lost sight of.
Ms. Loomis.
Mr. Bean, have you ever been the one who was looking over the agency's left shoulder?
I have certainly been one who has closely followed the agency's implementation of the Endangered Species Act, yes.
Were you the Director of Wildlife Conservation at the Environmental Defense Fund from 1977 to 2008?
Yes, I was.
During those years, was The Environmental Defense Fund, party to at least 138 lawsuits, most of them against the federal government and some involving the Endangered Species Act?
To my recollection, during the time I was there, there were two or three lawsuits involving the Fish and Endangered Species Act.
Has the Endangered, the Environmental Defense Fund been involved in any litigation that was ESA related since then, since you joined the administration?
Not to my knowledge.
Has it been party to almost 90 lawsuits against the federal government?
Since I left, I have no idea what's happened since I've left.
Do you know what year the gray wolf met federal recovery goals in Wyoming?
I don't know the precise year, but it was some years ago, yes.
It was 2002. So here we are, 11 years, numerous lawsuits later. The Fish and Wildlife Service proposed national delisting in June 2013, correct?
I believe that's correct, yes.
Now, the extended public comment period, now twice, ends on March 27th of 2014. Is that correct?
Again, I don't know for sure. That sounds like it's in the ballpark, however.
Do you have a deadline for final decision on delisting the gray wolf?
The statute requires the Fish and Wildlife Service to make a final decision within 1 year after publishing a proposed rule.
With the gray wolf having first been introduced under Section 10J of the Environmental Species Act, which is the non-essential experimental populations, having met its first recovery goal in 2002, here it is 2014, and it's still not delisted, does that seem like a reasonable amount of time?
Just for correction, it has been delisted in not only in Wyoming, but throughout the North Rockies.
But not a national delisting.
That is correct.
Is Wyoming's management plan still being litigated?
I believe there is a lawsuit pending against the decision to delist. I don't think there's a challenge that I'm aware of, at least to the Wyoming management plan.
Were you aware that Secretary Salazar promised Wyoming a delisting decision of the grizzly bear by 2014?
I'm not aware of what Secretary Salazar may have said about
it. Are you aware that in December of 2013, a panel of state and federal wildlife officials recommended delisting?
What was the date again?
December 2013?
Yes.
When can we expect a proposal to delist?
I don't know precisely when, but I suspect you will see a proposal to delist reasonably soon.
Do you think that a 1% delisting rate is indicative of a successful program?
I don't think it's an appropriate measure of the success or failure of the program.
The Endangered Species Act passed over 40 years ago, and it's the last time it was amended, even tweaked, was in 1988. I have never heard a Republican or a Democrat suggest that the Endangered Species Act should be repealed. But I have heard people suggest in testimony before the Natural Resources Committee and before a committee, which Doc Hastings, who is chairman of the Natural Resources Committee, and I co-chair, that it should be amended and tweaked. And let me give you some ideas about some of the areas that we heard about from people testifying. We heard that local, state, and tribal governments should be involved in species management and listing decisions. Do you agree with that?
They should be, and they are.
We heard that they aren't at least adequately involved at the front end, and that they were not party to the multi-species listing petitions and the resultant settlement agreements that were set the priorities and the time periods for delisting the hundreds of species that were included in the multi-species listing petitions. Is that true? Were they involved or not? Were they part of the discussions in the settlement agreements?
Only the parties to the litigation were involved in those settlement agreements.
And why was that, since the law says that they should be involved?
Well, every opportunity that the law provides for states and tribes and citizens, for that matter, to have a say in whether or not species should be listed or not listed will be, in fact, carried out, because what the settlement agreement simply did was to set a schedule.
But the schedules were set without involving state, local, and tribal governments. So they were excluded from settlements that the Fish and Wildlife Service made with agencies that were suing them or nonprofit entities
that
were suing
them. They were not involved in setting the schedule. That is correct. They will have every right to be involved and will be involved in any proposals that may come pursuant to that schedule.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman, for running a generous clock.
Thank you. Second round, I informed everyone that we'll just open this up for more of a colloquy setting, and so it is entirely appropriate to be able to interject during this round in any line of questioning with anyone that is running a line of questions. So feel free. Let's get answers and be able to walk through the dialogue. Let me kick it off. There is a question on the data, and Mr. Chafe has brought this up as well. How common is it that data is withheld for the research at the beginning part of that? So I understand this is not the listing, but this is part of the beginning part of actually research of the emphasis to be able to look at these species.
Honestly, sir, I don't know how common it is. It is my understanding that the service typically relies upon published studies that are done by researchers who have collected data, and those researchers have invested their time, effort, energy, and so forth in collecting that data, and want the ability to publish additional studies with that data, and therefore it is not made available by them either to us or to other parties. So I think that situation is reasonably common, just as businesses, when they enter into agreements with the Fish and Wildlife Service, often seek to protect some of their data as proprietary.
Right, but here's the concern. You take a, we've discussed before, you and I, the lesser prairie chicken. The lesser prairie chicken, five states are dealing with significant financial changes. It's not been listed, as you mentioned before. It's not listed as threatened, not listed as endangered. Just being studied, just being evaluated. Oklahoma alone has spent millions of dollars trying to adjust around it, just with a threat hovering. Now, you deal with the sage grouse in Utah. I know you can say it's not been listed, but there's data that exists somewhere that no one can look at, that a state and then private landowners are going to spend millions of dollars trying to be able to protect a species on there, but no one also has access to the data. Do you see what the problem may be? So I'm spending millions of dollars fighting against data that I have no idea what it is, how accurate it is, how well researched it was. If it was even peer reviewed, I don't know what I'm fighting against. So I'm now suddenly fighting a ghost, and my own federal government is bringing the cost on me.
Well, sir, my understanding is that the Fish and Wildlife Service, before it makes any decision on the sage-grouse or, for that matter, the lesser prairie chicken, will rely upon all the information from all the sources, the states and others. And the studies, I think, that Mr. Chaffetz is referring to were peer-reviewed studies.
So they were available to other people, just not to the state.
Well, peer reviewers don't necessarily review underlying data. They review, as I understand it.
That would be odd, though. Just a dialogue. How do you peer review something without actually looking at the underlying data? Because you then have to rely on their opinion of the data rather than the data.
I think, sir, as I understand this, the typical peer review situation, peer review process, rather, involves reviewers analyzing the methodologies and the conclusions based upon the summaries of the data, but not the raw data themselves.
Yeah, see, I'm familiar with peer reviews. It typically goes back to evaluate. They're checking their math, not just their grammar. They're actually looking back into the documents as well to say, is this conclusion correct based on the data itself? And so if you've got a reviewer that's reviewing based only, they're really doing a grammar check at that point, not a mathematical check, and that becomes a big issue. Again, you've got people spending millions of dollars, and it's one person that has drawn conclusions that I won't let you see where I got those conclusions from.
Well, if I have misstated the situation, I will happily correct the record later, but I have described to you what my understanding is.
I understand. Is there a way that we can actually get some transparency, though, into the operation that people can see it? Because you can understand the situation. If someone were to come and say, I believe that Fish and Wildlife Service or NOAA should look at this particular species, that there's a major problem here, and I think you should do a review, which is very costly to the American taxpayer and very time-consuming to Fish and Wildlife and NOAA. You should do this review. They're going to bring a citizen suit on it, but they're going to tell you, I think there's a major problem, but by the way, I'm not going to give you our data. You can't look at it. You're just going to have to trust me on this one that there's a major problem. You then have to kick in and engage. All the people have to then mitigate something that may or may not even be a problem.
Well, I can assure you it really doesn't work like that. The service does not simply act upon somebody coming to it and saying, here's what I think, I'm not showing you any data. Rather, the service responds to situations in which there are published peer-reviewed studies, there are maybe data from the states. I mentioned that the states themselves are frequently a source of information for
Right, but the majority are citizen suits still, not from the states.
There may be citizen petitions, but even those rely upon state-generated data frequently, because keep in mind, virtually every state has its own endangered species laws.
Sure.
And so every state has data, has information about the status of species in that state.
Frequently,
that information is woven into the petitions.
Could that data originate from someone doing a graduate study in their master's or doctoral work, and that becomes the study that's then proposed?
It could be.
So the publishing is not necessarily publishing in a research journal. It could be just publishing their dissertation.
I think, again, it could be.
Okay. So, again, we're back to the same issue. A graduate student, I have nothing against graduate students, could do a study that could be even fairly recent into the studies of different animals and different biology and such. The best that they know and understand as a graduate student, there's a limitation on this. They write a paper, they publish it, and then suddenly a state goes into millions of dollars of expenses and a tremendous amount of effort goes. It goes back to this conversation that we have as a nation, balancing the issue of data in this term that I've heard before, best professional judgment. How do we balance those two? Because the statute seems to lean towards this requirement that we get data, and you know, we talked about from NOAA that they're actually going out and scanning it. They know they've got a baseline. With fish and wildlife, there's just no way to be able to get a baseline of every single species of plant, animal, and fish. We just don't have any way to possibly do that. So how do you balance between data, best professional judgment, when there's no baseline number to come from, when you can actually have someone that's a graduate student someplace and say, I only see 20 of them in this area, and then extrapolate from that, I assume there used to be millions of them in this area, when we really don't know at that point?
Well, to address your hypothetical, hypothetically that could happen. In actuality, I'm not aware of any examples like that. So
you know the first study from the lesser prairie chicken where it came to attention from? Was it from a published or was it from a doctoral thesis?
The first study, I don't know.
Or the first attention that came to fish and wildlife on the lesser prairie chicken?
I don't know.
I believe it was from a doctoral dissertation that came. It's this route. This is a route that is occurring. Mm-hmm. And our state has spent millions of dollars. And other states have spent millions of dollars. And it's not listed. So it's a matter of how do we manage this at this point? How do we manage the difference between data? And I want to pass this. I want others to be able to engage in this conversation. How do you manage from day to day the difference between having hard data, the science of it, and best professional judgment, where you may have some species that there are very few people that actually study that particular species? So the best available judgment may be three people that are scientists that study this particular species.
Well, the Fish and Wildlife Service seldom has perfect data or all the data that it needs to make a decision. So it has to rely upon professional judgment in interpreting data often. The service does not use judgment to create data, but it uses judgment to interpret and understand the data that it has.
No, I'm not accusing of you creating that. It just still goes back to if you have very limited data and you have very limited number of people that study that particular species, now you have a situation where someone's going into the trying to determine and then trying to figure out how to mitigate all the issues around it when we really don't have data and we have very few people that have looked at it. You're managing hundreds of things that are coming on with citizen petitions. You don't have time to manage this either. But we're quickly moving an issue that was designed to be able to protect species, but we don't have time to study it, we don't have enough people to look at it, and we don't have enough data to evaluate it. It puts us all in a very difficult position, both the species and the people that live around it. You and I have talked about the American burrowing beetle, and we can discuss that more. We can't really study the American burrowing beetle much. They live underground. But there's a tremendous amount that happens in construction that's now slowed. Pipeline construction, bridge construction, wind power construction, utility construction, that now can't build in certain times of the year because we think maybe, possibly, though we don't have data, that the American burrowing beetle may be in that area.
The Fish and Wildlife Service has a pretty good sense of the areas that may be occupied by the beetle, for example. and it has some techniques to determine presence. You're right, the beetle lives underground much of its life, but it spends some of its life above ground and is routinely attracted to lights, so there are ways to determine whether it's present in an area or not.
Right.
The service, to the extent of its ability, bases its decisions upon the best available information that it has, and it puts a heavy emphasis upon peer-reviewed and high-quality data and analysis, and primarily published data. That isn't always available, but the standard that Congress has given the service to guide its decisions is that of best available scientific information.
Can we talk a little bit? Well, first of all, let me point out that we just had a discussion about the gray wolf in Wyoming. It is presently delisted.
That is correct.
Which means the population can be exterminated.
Well, it's, it, this population, what it means is that the population is managed by the state of Wyoming. The state of Wyoming does not intend to exterminate the wolf, but they do intend to manage it.
Exterminate was not the right word. They can be shot.
They can shoot it. They can hunt it, yes.
So I've been told that since delisting, the gray wolf population has declined by some 16% in Wyoming, 4% in Montana, and 11% in Idaho. Now, I don't know what that percent means. Is that a percent that should be of concern to us, or is that healthy? My understanding also is that there's fewer than 1,600 of these animals in those three states. So I realize they're predatory animals, and that, you know, if they're killing your herd or your cattle, that's problematic. But I also would like to have a better understanding of, now that it's being delisted, Ms. Lumens is concerned about the length of time it's taking, but it's already delisted, the numbers have been declining. Is this anything that we should be concerned about?
Representative Speer, since the wolf was delisted, not only in Wyoming, but Idaho and Montana, all of those three states, each of those three states has managed the wolf and has allowed hunting and has reduced somewhat the populations, although the populations are still well above a level that the Fish and Wildlife Service regards as safe, in the sense that the service doesn't need to reconsider putting it back on the endangered species list. They're well above that number.
Okay. So let's move on to the lawsuit issue, which, you know, by numbers that I mentioned in my opening statement would suggest the numbers have declined dramatically. But even if you do file a lawsuit, does not mean that if you win the lawsuit, that the Fish and Wildlife Service will delist or list the creature. Is that correct?
I think you're referring to the deadline lawsuits, of which there have been many, filed against the Fish and Wildlife Service for its failure to meet the statutory deadlines for responding to petitions. The statute has some explicit statutory deadlines for responding to a petition, and because of the volume of petitions, the service has sometimes missed those deadlines, and then the petitioner has sued the Fish and Wildlife Service for the purpose of getting a court-ordered deadline. So you're right that those lawsuits do not result in decisions to list species. They result in decisions to either propose or not propose a listing of a species by a certain date.
And finally, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to have to leave to go to another meeting, so I thank you for indulging my questions here. If everyone is supportive of retaining the Endangered Species Act, which is what I was hearing from some of my colleagues, and there are opportunities to allow for development and protection of the endangered species, and habitat conservation plans being a great way of doing so, and I guess been used very successfully. What things should you have, what tools should you have to create greater flexibility so that we can protect endangered species, development can happen, hunting can happen, and we can all sing kumbaya?
Well, thank you for the question, and I certainly agree with the premise that habitat conservation plans have been a very effective way of reconciling development interests with conservation interests. I think, frankly, you know, more you know, more understanding of the potential application of that tool to solve various problems, and more understanding of the availability of tools like safe harbor agreements that Georgia landowners are using, California landowners are using, and others, will be helpful in bringing to the attention of the public, particularly the landowning public, the whole panoply of tools that are potentially available to help them live compatibly and successfully with endangered species on or near their land.
Well, I guess I'm asking if you want any additional tools. Would it be helpful to give you any additional tools of flexibility beyond those that exist?
I think the Fish and Wildlife Service is currently exploring some administrative initiatives, much like safe harbor agreements and candidate conservation agreements, which were administratively developed. It is exploring the use of mitigation banking in a more aggressive manner to allow some landowners to basically invest in conservation on their land as a way of offsetting the impacts of development on others' lands. That's an idea that's been used widely in California as well. It's something the Fish and Wildlife Service is currently exploring ways to improve or expand the availability of that. So that would be one example.
And you could do that without legislation?
Yes, I believe we could.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Can I ask a quick follow-up? And I want to interrupt. I know others want to be able to. When will we be able to see those proposed ideas? Will that come out through the rulemaking process, or will that just appear?
No, it will come out as a proposal in the Federal Register. There will be an opportunity for any interested person to weigh in on it.
Okay. Can you give me a time frame on that? Are we talking 2014, 15, 16?
We are definitely, well, I very strongly believe it will be 2014 and probably early 2014.
Okay. Thank you. Other members who want to contribute?
Mr. Chairman, how many species, what percentage of species that for which listing petitions have been filed have been listed?
I don't know the precise percentage.
More than not?
Of those for which decisions have been made, yes, more than not, a majority. Well, like, actually, I'm not certain. I'll have to...
Roughly, well, the information I have is that it's about 85%.
Of all petitions since the Act was passed? I don't really know.
The mitigation banking that you mentioned, that's something we're using in Wyoming that the private sector is using pretty substantially. Is federal land going to be allowed to participate in mitigation banks? Because you know about our irrational, I would call it, land ownership patterns in Wyoming, where you have private land commingled with federal land, with state land. And so it does make some sense if you've got a landscape-sized mitigation project, mm-hmm. that where there's BLM land, for example, interspersed with private land, that the BLM land should be considered part of the mitigation bank.
Ms. Lamas, I met with some of your Wyoming constituents this week to discuss mitigation banking, and they are developing a proposal, as I understand it, that would include both private and BLM and maybe state lands. And I think the Fish and Wildlife Service will, when it's presented with that proposal, assuming it is, be sort of welcoming of that idea. Until we see the details, we can't say for sure whether it will be approved or not, but it certainly, on the face of it, seems like a good idea.
Well, since we do know that on a landscape scale, we can probably achieve better results for protection of habitat, which equals protection of species a lot of the time, it seems to make a lot of sense to me that the federal government would cooperate with private landowners who wish to provide mitigation banking lands at a landscape scale. It seems to be working pretty well. Our science, our ability to understand science, has improved, in your opinion, since the Endangered Species Act passed, correct?
I suppose so, yes.
You suppose so? Do you not really believe that?
I'm not sure how you would measure it, but I suppose it would be, yes.
Okay, well, Let me ask it this way. Do you think science has been static since 1973?
Of course not.
Do you think that people's environmental ethic has been static since 1973?
Probably not.
Do you think that people in general are more attuned to their stewardship responsibilities to the environment than they were in 1973?
Probably so.
I think so, too. In fact, I think it has become embedded. It's cultural now, much more so than it was when the Endangered Species Act is passed. I think that the culture has grown in its sensitivity and in its stewardship obligations to species, to clean water, clean air, clean land. And I think that's why things like our compliance with the Kyoto protocols for clean air have been met, and we're the only country that met those Kyoto protocols, even though we didn't sign onto the Kyoto protocols. Americans have a marvelous stewardship and an environmental sensitivity that is cultural. It is embedded. And to that extent, litigation, in my opinion, that puts briefcases in courtrooms but not species on conserved habitat, isn't the answer in the 21st century. To me, the answer in the 21st century is boots on the ground conservation by people who are culturally attuned to preserve species, be they tribal members or state government employees or private landowners working together to conserve species. So to take an act that passed in 1973 and was last amended in 1988, where the people, the culture, has gone far beyond the ethos of the act, and expect that act and its litigation-driven model to be the way we should administer the law in the 21st century, is a lot like driving an Edsel in 2014 and thinking that it ought to perform like a 2014 car. You know, the performance of automobiles is better. The performance of the American people with regard to science and culture and the ethics of species conservation have improved. So I would really like to see the Endangered Species Act updated to acquaint it with and harmonize it with the culture and the ethos and the ethics and the stewardship that the American people are quite capable of providing. It doesn't need to be done in the courtroom anymore. Those funds that are so difficult to come by can be spent on habitat conservation and boots on the ground species recovery without lawyers in the courtroom earning the money and taking that precious financial resource that is so hard to come by away from the very species that the Endangered Species Act was designed to protect. Mr. Chairman, thank you. I yield back.
Mr. Chairman, if I could follow up on that, I want to ask, because listening to both Ms. Lummis and the chairman, it felt oddly adversarial to me. I'm thinking, for Pete's sakes, the chairman's talking about millions of dollars that are being spent that are not directed at something that we've come together on and tried to unify our might to solve, but directed towards ambiguities. Ms. Lummis doesn't just live this every day back home, but isn't talking through her hat when she talks about a conservation ethos. And obviously, things have changed over the last 40 years. Obviously, what President Nixon envisioned is not where we are today. Are we close? Are we further? We can have that conversation, but obviously, we're not exactly where folks thought we would be 40 years later. Why does it feel adversarial? Why isn't it a big kumbaya session to say let's make some changes and let's refocus our resources on those most critical missions? I can't think of the last time I was involved in an ESA problem-solving session that was on its way to fruition, I can think of many ESA arguments that I've been involved in. Tell me why that is. Why aren't we moving closer to a common goal today?
Well, sir, I'll be happy to offer my own experience as an answer to your question. My own experience is I've worked with landowners in your state. I mentioned the forest landowners in the Red Hills area. I've worked with forest landowners in North Carolina in the Sand Hills area. I've worked in ranchers in ranch land in Texas. In particular, I mentioned to Mr. Lankford yesterday a gentleman named Bob Long, who was chairman of the Republican Party of Bastrop County, Texas, local bank president, fundamentalist minister, extreme conservative, but somebody who was willing to manage his land to help recover an endangered amphibian called the Houston toad. And what I learned from that work with him and those other landowners is that a lot of this acrimony or contention that has been talked about today in this room doesn't really exist at that level. People are willing to roll up their sleeves and work together with the Fish and Wildlife Service, with the organization for which I worked, with which Mrs. Lummis mentioned. And one doesn't get that sense often out on the ground talking to people where these efforts are ongoing. So I can only answer based on my experience, but my experience is that when you offer landowners an opportunity to work constructively with the Fish and Wildlife Service in a way that each understands the needs of the others and tries to accommodate them, you can have success.
I'm afraid you're making my point exactly. That's my experience on the ground, too. So when the chairman says he sees millions of dollars being wasted on efforts that we're not directing together, why aren't we equally incensed about that? When Ms. Lummis says that there are dollars being errantly directed to litigation instead of mitigation, and you talk about your successful experiences one-on-one on the ground, why aren't we rushing to agree with Ms. Lummis and talk about proposed changes to the statute to foster what is the most hard-fought commodity in this nation, not the all-precious and incredibly too limited American dollar, but the all-precious and incredibly limited trust that goes between citizens and their government. What you say, I will stipulate is true. So what next? Why isn't the next conversation then that collaborative sitting around the table making changes to the statute to amplify those successes and mitigate these failures?
Well, sir, perhaps the answer is that all the examples I gave, or none of the examples I gave, required amending the law. All of the examples I gave required creatively interpreting and applying the law. And I think what this act has shown, despite the fact that it has remained unchanged by Congress since 1988, it has been changed substantially by the Fish and Wildlife Service in its implementation, but in its use of new tools that didn't exist in 1973 or 1988 in order to engage landowners as partners, in order to better engage states in order to make use of the flexible authorities I described. The Act has been, in my judgment, remarkably flexible and adaptive. I don't for a minute mean to suggest that there aren't controversies, but as I tried to make the point with respect to the Oregon chub in the outset, most of the species, most of the time, don't generate those controversies. Progress is being made without lots of headlines, without lots of heat, without lots of rancor.
If I could just take one last stab at it, you're absolutely right. The successes that you mentioned don't require changing the statute at all, but the failures that my colleagues mentioned did. I don't know why it is that somehow we have to choose between having both the successes and the failures, or having neither the success nor the failures. I don't think that's the world that we live in. I think we could have the successes and even greater successes and eliminate those failures. But again, just one last effort. Am I wrong about that? Again, you're talking about successes that don't require changes. My colleagues are talking about failures that do require changes. Why aren't we coming together around eliminating the failures and amplifying the successes?
We may have a disagreement about the failures. In Mr. Lankford's case, I don't think the money that is being spent is being wasted. I think the money is being invested to find out what the status of the the lesser prairie chicken really is. And I think that will be very helpful to us in deciding whether we need to protect it, and if so, how we need to protect it. So I don't for a minute suggest that it isn't oftentimes difficult and sometimes expensive in order to get answers to these questions, but I think investing and finding out the answers is not necessarily a waste of resources or money or time.
Mr. Chairman, I thank you.
No, it's most, and thank you, Mr. Woodall, but it's most certainly not a waste of time to be able to protect species. We wholeheartedly agree with that. A couple of challenges just on the intensity of it. One is the sense of, as you mentioned, the creative interpretation of the law and how flexible the law is and how many times it has changed in its application over the past 40 years brings some concern to individuals that just want consistency. They just want to know, here's the law and here's how it's applied and I know what it is. When it changes at different points, then there's great consternation. People just want to know, here's the law, here's how it's going to be applied. That's some of the conversation up here as well, to say there may be needs for fixes in the law because it seems to change often, though it hasn't actually changed. Does that make sense?
I understand your point. However, the examples I gave are all examples in which the law was made to be more flexible and accommodating to landowner or regulated interest concerns. So I think as a practical matter, nobody objected to those changes. People welcomed those changes.
Right. It's the how they're coming at and how the species are being identified and put up in front of landowners. Let me just read part of a statement here, and I know every state has its own unique species that they get a chance to have significant conversations about. Let me read you a document just that's the summary of key components. This comes official federal document coming out. Summary key components for conservation of lesser prairie chicken. And here's just the summary of it from the executive summary. The primary threats dealing with the lesser prairie chicken. There are five areas here, six. Inappropriate timing and intensity of livestock grazing. In other words, grazing wrong place, wrong time. Conversion of native prairie for development and crop production, which I thought was interesting. In other words, we're having issues with this because we're planting crops there instead. Alteration of fire regimes. By the way, if you go into the details of the study assumes that in Oklahoma there used to be wildfires all the time and no one stopped them, and that was good for the chicken. I would assume I've had very well-cooked chicken over a fire before, and I don't know that was good for it, but it's a whole different issue. Introduction and expansion of noxious weeds, fragmentation of habitat with roads, utility corridors, fences, towers, turbines, or energy development, and the planting of trees. So when folks in Oklahoma read this, here's what they read as the next paragraph. Features associated with human development is the quote here. And then the quote before that is the issue being returning the situation to prior European settlement status. So I want you to understand that people get a little concerned when a document comes out and says, if we're going to protect the lesser prairie chicken, we need to return Western Oklahoma to a situation that it looks like prior European settlement status, and that there may be a problem with planting of trees, building roads, planting crops, or grazing cattle. Those are kind of things that people do. And so you understand the situation here and why the immediate frustration comes up if you were to read this and think, that's my land, there would be a concern immediately.
Yes, indeed. I don't know what document you're referring to, but I can assure you that the Fish and Wildlife Service has no intention of trying to return to pre-European conditions in Oklahoma or elsewhere. We recognize that isn't going to happen, and that isn't going to be the strategy that the service pursues.
I'll bring you the document. I won't add this to the record, but I'll bring you the document and be able to walk through. But if you go through the original study that triggered this, it's loaded throughout the entire study. There's also great statements in there about that lesser prairie chickens are concerned about anything taller than 13 feet. And so they don't want to have any construction in Western Oklahoma taller than 13 feet. I'm not sure how they knew that lesser prairie chickens were okay with something 12 feet, but not 14 feet. But it's loaded throughout the entire study. This becomes a big issue for individuals as we spend millions of dollars based around a study that's not based on, as it comes through this over and over again, that's not based on population count, it's based on habitat. And that's an issue I want to be able to deal with both of you on. How do we balance this issue? When a species comes to light, there's an assumption always, we've only found so many, and so you assume there used to be more. though oftentimes there's not a count. Now, you have mentioned NOAA occasionally. You all have done population counts, and you're tracking those in certain areas at certain times. You're aware of a certain population count. Many times in Fish and Wildlife, that's just not possible with every plant species to know what was the population count 100 years ago based on what it is right now. But some assumptions are made, so we need to protect this habitat. But then there's also, correct me if I'm wrong here, oftentimes when we have listing, we're not listing it and saying, to come off delisting, we need to go to a certain population. It seems to state that this species is listed because the habitat's diminishing. The only way to be able to delist them, it would sound like, would be for the habitat to increase. Tell me where I'm wrong on that.
The way to delist a species once it's listed is to remove the threats. And those threats may be addressed in manners other than what you suggest.
Could those threats be a road or a utility pole or a house taller than 13 feet?
Likely not, in the sense that in the sense that what needs to be done is to remove enough threats in enough places in order to ensure that the species has a good chance of surviving. That may mean protecting some land in perpetuity. It may mean securing cooperative agreements with willing private landowners to manage their lands in ways compatible with the needs of the species. It certainly doesn't mean removing all trees, removing all development, what have you. As I said a moment ago, this notion of returning to pre-European conditions is not the goal or strategy or intent of the Fish and Wildlife Service.
Okay. Mr. Rock, you've been gracefully quiet on this. We've had a lot of conversations with Mr. Bean. Let's talk a little bit about the habitat issue and numerical counts. How are you tracking that as far as dealing with a species and getting them delisted?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We do, when we set recovery plans, we try to set standards for recovery. And many of those do have numerical counts. We do have...
Is that typical at the beginning, that everyone kind of knows we think the population is decreasing, if we get to this number, we're going to delist?
No. It is typical when we do a recovery plan, which is often not when we do the listing. Sometimes it takes a while to do the recovery plan after the listing, and we do it in consult with some of our state partners, private landowners, and other kinds of people are involved in that process.
Can you just help me? It takes a while. Is that 6 months, a year? Is that 10 years? How long is that?
It can vary. Sometimes it's quicker.
Quicker?
More than 6 months.
Okay, so give me some time frames here. A year to 10 years?
A year to 10 years, would somewhere in there. It varies by species, and we have some species, particularly foreign species, which is, since there's very little the U.S. can do about them, that we don't prioritize our recovery plans. For the U.S., we tend to prioritize them higher, but there is no particular deadline for doing a recovery plan. Because it is designed, and we try to maximize the participation of landowners and states in that, we often can't dictate the time frame. We come to the table when they come to the table and we have these discussions, and sometimes that takes a while to get to a common vision of what it needs to recover the species. But it is almost certainly longer than a year. Hopefully it is less than 10 years in most instances.
So same thing for Fish and Wildlife, Mr. Bean. The recovery plan may take a year to 10 years, and that's where a numerical population goal is set.
I think the Fish and Wildlife Service informal goal is to try to have recovery plans done within 3 years of listing, which it is able to do in most instances.
Population goal is attached to that?
Sometimes, rarely, if ever, is a recovery plan goal expressed solely in terms of population. And there are almost always other objectives as well beyond population goals.
Well, let's go back to Mr. Chaffetz's comment earlier when we were talking about the fabulous Utah prairie dog. The last thing that I read on it was estimating the population somewhere around 40,000. Is that number correct, not correct? I don't know. Quick facts and figures on prairie dogs,
yes,
here,
sir.
But
I don't know, but I believe it's much lower than that, sir.
Okay, we'll try to pull the number. The last thing I saw had around 40,000 total on that. That may be the issue of between public lands and private lands. A larger survey done with both at 40,000, public lands may be lower than that. And that becomes still the study of, we trying to recover them in public lands where they may or may not prefer to be. They may prefer to be more in someone's flower bed than they would in public lands where it's not necessarily a flower bed as well, based on the preference of it. How do they know when that animal's coming off?
I don't know the recovery goals in the recovery plan, but there is a recovery plan for the Utah prairie dog, and it does set forth goals for delisting. And the Fish and Wildlife Service will keep track of trends with respect to both population, habitat condition, and so forth. And when those, either when those goals are met, or when the Fish and Wildlife Service has other reason to conclude that the species no longer is endangered, it would initiate a status review and a proposal to delist.
Yeah, it's a challenge with a species like the prairie dog, obviously. That's a nuisance creature, quite frankly, cute as can be on someone else's yard, but in yours it's a problem.
Most landowners in Utah look at it that way, but not all. I worked with one named Alan Henry, who entered into a safe harbor agreement basically to allow Utah prairie dogs to occupy some of his land, and there were other landowners as well. So while what you say is generally true, it's not true of all the landowners.
My house in Oklahoma, a couple of years ago, I distinctly remember complaining to my next-door neighbor about armadillos, which will shred your yard, and in my particular yard was absolutely shredding them overnight. And he chastised me for saying that and said, armadillos are so slow, you can just get a trash can, load them up, go get them because they're so slow, and go haul them out into the country and drop them off. And about 2 weeks later, at about 9 o'clock at night, I heard a shotgun blast next door and walked outside and found my neighbor standing over a dead armadillo who was shredding his yard. And so, yeah, at times there is this perception of that. I get that. But there is something unique when we're dealing with how are we trying to recover a species. And I don't want to talk about shooting armadillos, but there are some serious issues that we deal with in recovering a species that once landowners are pushing back significantly, saying we're being overrun, how do we manage that? Whether that be a gray wolf that's taking down significant parts of a herd, or whether that is a prairie dog that they're being overrun with in certain communities and can do nothing about. I want to run through a couple things quickly. I want to be attentive to our time as well. I want to go through solutions. I'm interested in two sets of things. One that I can bring to say, what do you think about this? One is ideas that you have. You've already mentioned one of those, Mr. Bean, as well, of ways to be able to create an environment for more collaboration that you said is going to be an issue that will be put out in the Federal Register in the coming days. Can we form a clear definition of the difference between threatened and endangered and how they're handled with landowners and status? Because we seem to have emerging, from my understanding of the law, and I'm no professional on it, from its history, is that threatened and endangered used to be really distinct. And now there seems to be a third category that's created with, we're looking at listing this, and so it kicks in a whole series of things, and then we have a threatened listing and then endangered listing. It appears to me the threatened used to be this other status that's created in the past, that now we've grown into three statuses. Am I correct or not correct on that historically? Can you pull the microphone a little closer as well?
Yeah, excuse me. For listed species, there have always been just two categories, threatened and endangered. Recently, the two services, I believe, have utilized this notion of candidate species
right,
under consideration for possible.
Has threatened always meant the same thing, though? Threatened seems to be candidate level now, and candidate seems to be something new that's been added to it.
I wouldn't characterize it that way. I would say that threatened species have always been species that aren't yet endangered, but they're likely to become so in the foreseeable future. Candidate species are species that for which there is concern that they may warrant listing as threatened or endangered. It's worth pointing out there are no regulatory requirements that attach to candidate species, no federal regulatory requirements.
And that's one of my questions on it, is where did that come from? Is the candidate type listing? Is that from statute? Is that from regulation? Or
it originated from as a response to the fact that the Fish and Wildlife Service responded to petitions by acknowledging that certain species that had been petitioned may warrant listing, but there were higher priorities to deal with first, and so those basically were put in queue. And those in queue were considered to be candidate species. I think the word candidate now appears in the statute, but it did not originally appear in the statute.
In the statute or in the regulations?
I think in the statute, if I recall correctly.
Mr. Rauch, do you know on that one or how you're handling that, where this the candidate has risen up?
I cannot recall where it has risen up, but I can confirm that we do, as well as the Fish and Wildlife Service, use those species to try to engage with landowners in a non-regulatory fashion ahead of a listing so that we can avoid listings. There's a lot more options that you can do while the species is not at its...
Are we having better recovery of species in the candidate phase or in the threatened phase?
I'm not sure that we completely track recovery in the threatened phase, because recovery means, under the statute, recover to the point where the ESA mandates are no longer needed. Since the candidate species did not become listed in the first place,
right,
they're technically, the distinction doesn't really apply.
We're back to Mr. Bean's comment earlier. It's better to catch it earlier and to be able to go after it.
I completely agree with that.
Sure, but at that point, it's the state that's also managing it. Is that correct? Other than in federal waters?
Yes.
Okay, so we need some clarification on what candidate means, because that's one of the areas that there is some concern nationwide in different entities, that when something suddenly becomes a candidate, no one really knows what that means fully. They just know the hammer is coming down quickly on them, and they're trying to figure out what do we do, and that is a nebulous threat. So we do need some clarification on that in the days ahead. Making data publicly available. I know we've had some conversation about this in the research part of it. I'm trying to figure out why that's still a bad idea, that we can peer review data. And if someone's going to bring an issue and say, I've studied this, but no one else can second guess me on it, and because this data is proprietary, there is a major problem with that when individuals and states, counties, and tribes are going to spend millions of dollars mitigating for a risk that they can't actually verify. Any disagreement on that or any solutions on how we resolve that?
All I would say, beyond what I've said already, is I'll be happy to explore this further within the agency to see, first of all, if my understanding is correct, and secondly, if there are reasonable solutions.
Mr. Rock, anything you'd share with that?
I can't speak to the discussions about the sage-grouse or the specific instances you're talking about. We do value public and peer review data. We recently, when we're dealing with the coral listing, we put all our science out in a broad peer-reviewed document to the extent that we had it and make it available. I can confirm that there are instances in which we would like to release data, but we don't have it because the researchers won't give it to us. So that appears to be what's happening in the Fish and Wildlife Service. That does happen to us on occasion. It does create issues. But we would prefer, and where we can, we try to make all of our data publicly available.
I can say what we do with anonymous letters where people don't give us backup. We don't take them seriously. If I can't verify your number, if I can't verify your information, I'm not going to take it seriously, because I'm not going to take trust me as an answer. Even if you're a respected researcher, every person makes mistakes, and every bit of data should be peer-reviewed and should be public. And if states and individuals are going to be put into a status where they have to spend millions of dollars to mitigate for something, they should be able to back it up and to be able to agree or disagree, and you can't do that. That's the basic American principle of I should be able to face my accuser, and if suddenly the accuser says, no, there's a problem, but I can't tell you why, we have a problem as a nation. That is one we have to resolve. States getting involved and the affected parties being involved in any kind of consent decree or the research of an entity at the start, rather than finding out much later. How do we get affected parties involved at the very beginning of this and accelerate that process? And you've mentioned several times, Mr. Bean, that states are made aware of this and they're engaged. How do we get them at the very beginning engaged? Any ideas on that?
I will say that we are currently engaged in a joint state-federal task force with the states to talk about their involvement. We have a series of ongoing meetings. The next one's coming up next month in Denver, where we talk with them about that exact question, about how they can be not just engaged, but meaningfully engaged in this process. There are many roles, as Mr. Bean said, for the states to become involved in the process of the substantive decision, and we do take that seriously and look to make sure that is a meaningful and that we can fully take account of the data that they have, the expertise that they have, and bring that to the decision.
Right. Effective party. Again, you're going to back to a basic American principle. The federal government exists to be able to serve the people, and affected parties should be at the table and should be very aware of that. So getting them there at the very beginning makes a huge difference. Mr. Bean, any comments on that? I want to move on to other things, if not.
Just one comment. The Interior Department has provided support to the western states to develop what are known as crucial habitat assessment tools, acronym is CHATS. These are Internet accessible databases of the most important areas in those western states for a variety of purposes, wildlife habitats, wildlife migratory corridors, and the like. So that investment by the federal government to assist the states in developing that data is proving very useful in identifying those places on the map where conflicts are likely to be most acute, and conversely, those places on the map where conflicts are likely to be least likely. So I think that's a good way to further your goal of having state and federal cooperation.
Right. And you're fully aware, once we get into the western United States, my state included, that the push is on in many areas to be able to protect where we are now, and it leaves the implication right where we are in the level of development we are is the right level of development, and we're pushing through habitat, and it has the feeling in the western part of the United States of, we don't want you to grow. You're going to stay right where you are. Now, I understand the words are, that's we can coexist, but when the focus is on habitat erosion rather than population counts, it sends the clear signal, not developing energy in this area, not developing wind power in this area, not developing homes or cities or roads in this area, sends a pretty clear signal, you have to stay at this spot. And that becomes a concern when the focus is habitat rather than population. A couple things. Is there a way to be able to move to an arbitration system for the citizen petitions to expedite this process, to be able to help clear the deck? If you've got a high number of these that don't end up going through the rest of the process that are cleared, is there a faster route to do this to be more efficient for the services to take care of this?
That's an idea I have not heard discussed, so I don't have, I haven't given it much thought, but I will be happy to give it some thought.
Okay. Mr. Rao?
I've not thought about it either, and as I mentioned, I think, earlier, we do have listing petitions, not nearly as many as Fish and Wildlife Service, so we believe we were able to perform our work and stay on, in general, on schedule. We don't have the backlog that they've had.
Because there's nothing to stop a group coming to you with 2,000 species in a petition at this point. I mean, the continual ramp up is larger and larger, which becomes more irrational and unachievable. There has to be a way to be able to manage and to be able to mitigate this in the days ahead. Last piece on it, I want to have a couple other quick notes on it. The issue of data versus best professional judgment, how do we manage between the two to be able to create the maximum amount of trust? Because, again, if individuals and businesses and cities and states and tribes are going to spend millions of dollars in mitigation and they don't have data on it, they have someone's best professional judgment, and in many of these species, there's a very small group of individuals that are specialists in that species. How do we manage that to be able to create trust?
Mr. Chairman, I think that rarely the case, and it is probably never the case, that the Fish and Wildlife Service makes decisions just based upon somebody's opinion, devoid of reference to published studies or other real data. As I indicated in an earlier answer, there is often an absence of definitive data on many of the questions the service has to answer, and thus it has to use judgment in how it interprets or applies the information and data that exists. But the service takes seriously the statutory command to base its decisions on the best available scientific information, and tries to do that consistently.
Yeah, that's the grand challenge. Again, when you're dealing with a species, when you're dealing with someone who's published a paper that no one else has tracked before, and it again assumes it used to be higher than what it is now, it's only this. Certainly it was larger than that at some point. No one knows. And how do you track that, and now what do we do as a reaction to that? Again, no one's looking to be able to wipe out a species, but neither are we looking for all of our lives to be turned upside down because someone wrote a research paper that was published. We have to be able to find a balance between those two.
Sir, may I just offer the observation that while it's obviously impossible to say what the population may have been at some point in the past, it is possible to determine that a species was present in certain places in the past where it is no longer present today. We have that from collection records, from museum records, from accounts from explorers and others. Right. So it is possible to document loss of range for many of these species.
Right. We also have a documentation of loss of range for dinosaurs that we can document as well, that was not due to human activity or whatever it may be. And so that's species come and go. We're very aware of that. We have every obligation to be able to protect the species. As an evangelical Christian myself, I have this overwhelming sense that we have a responsibility to take care of what God has given us. But it is also a challenge to be able to do that in an economic sense that also allows for the movement of people to be able to process through that. There is a statement, there are several questions that I wanted to be able to put in the record. I think both of you all may have heard of a group called the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. They occasionally have disagreements on some of the ESA applications. I'd like to ask unanimous consent, which I'm pretty confident I will get, to be able to put this into the record as well, and some of the other questions and thoughts that they had as a part of this. Final statements that either of you gentlemen would like to make, or observations or ideas?
Just thank you for your interest. As you indicated when I talked to you yesterday, you wanted to have an honest, candid discussion, and I think we've had that, so I appreciate that very much.
You bet. Thank you. Mr. Rao?
Thank you for the opportunity to come here and share our views with you.
Thank you. We'll have, obviously, this conversation is not done, but we'll continue to work on solutions and how we resolve some issues and to be able to make this as clear as possible in the days ahead. With that, this hearing is adjourned.